All right, thank y'all. I'd like to thank the Alabama Department of Archives and History for inviting me to speak today about Streight's Raid. I'd also like to thank Steve Murray and Tree Hamill for being such gracious hosts today. You know, over the years, I've spent a lot of time in this building and various states of this building. And, you know, 10 years ago, I lived in Montgomery, so Montgomery's always kind of been a home away from home for me. So, you know, I hope y'all enjoyed the presentation today, you know, about Streight's Raid. I also grew up right outside of Rome, Georgia, and when you grow up outside of Rome, Georgia, Streight's Raid's kind of like Gettysburg there. You know, everywhere else when I was a little kid, I'd go around and we'd go to Kentucky or somewhere like that, and we'd get talking about Civil War, I'd be like, yeah, Streight's Raid. They're looking at me kind of scratching their head because it's pretty insignificant raid overall. I mean, it's not really known outside of Alabama and Northwest Georgia very well. In fact, if you look, like Ken Burns' series, most of the big works on the compiled volumes of the Civil War, I was going through a lot of those the last couple of weeks, and very few of them even make mention of Streight's Raid at all. My presentation tonight, I really hope to kind of bring out some of the real important aspects of the raid that I think are critical to understand the Civil War and bits of Alabama. The history of Streight's Raid reads like the pages of a Hollywood script, a daring yet ill-advised and poorly executed raid launched behind enemy lines across rugged and hostile terrain to sever the enemy's communications. Among the raiding party, a group of Alabamians in blue risk it all to maintain their allegiance to the old Union in defiance of a fledgling infant rebel nation. In pursuit rode the mythical Wizard of the Saddle, whose every heroic action, whether real or imagined, became part of a larger-than-life legend. A young heroine of common birth, whose beauty, improved with each mention of her name, finds herself in the right place at the right time, lifting this ordinary, illiterate girl to historical immortality. As the invading forces neared their target, a Paul Revere figure emerged to scamper across the Northwest Georgia countryside to call out the local civilian defense. Two weary armies beset by internal disagreements and external forces race across northern Alabama. One's journey ends in triumph, the other in humiliation, as the raiders surrender following a theatrical deception and trickery carried out by Nathan Bedford Forrest that even Shakespeare might applaud. As if begging for a sequel, the adventure continues long after the surrender to include a deadly duel and a daring prison escape. At first glance, the raid appears to have been a miserable failure, an event best left in the dustbin of history, or perhaps recalled on the pages of, quote, the weirdest events of the Civil War, or, quote, the greatest military debacles publications that you see in bookstores sometimes. Streight's Raid was a Union cavalry raid through northern Alabama that took place between April 19th and May 3rd, 1863, during the American Civil War. Historians often provide different start dates for the raid. I use April 19th because that's the date that Streight's forces actually arrived by boat at Eastport, Mississippi, and got off the boat. Now, it took them a couple days to get anywhere from there, but at least that's kind of where it started. Tomorrow will mark the 150th anniversary of the commencement of that moment of Streight's Raid. Beyond the fact that this raid took place in Alabama, we should ask ourselves, why should historians and public audiences devote some attention during the sesquicentennial commemorations to discuss Streight's Raid? We could talk about other things, right? What is it about this raid that tells us anything about the making of Alabama? Hopefully my presentation will shed some light upon why this tale is among the most popular tales remembered in our state. Colonel Abel Streight was responsible for planning the raid across northern Alabama. Prior to the war, Streight lived an affluent existence in Indianapolis, Indiana, where he owned a profitable lumber yard and printing business. He was an ardent supporter of the Republican Party and advocated for the abolition of slavery and viewed secession as nothing short of treason. Yet he believed that the Civil War was necessary and timely because the delay on the question of slavery any further, in his opinion, might result in a more deadly conflict in the long run. Streight lacked any previous military experience before the war. In September 1861, the governor of Indiana commissioned Streight to serve as colonel of the 51st Indiana Volunteer Infantry. As regimental commander, Streight saw limited action at the battles of Shiloh, Corinth, Perryville, and Stones River. In the winter of 1862-63, Streight returned to Indianapolis to recuperate from illness. Stuck at home, away from his troops, Streight became restless and began devising a plan that would significantly increase his role in the Civil War. He's a bit bored. Streight proposed to lead a force of mounted infantry and regular cavalry on a secretive raid across northern Alabama to strike the city of Rome, Georgia, and the Western and Atlantic Railroad, a critical manufacturing center and supply artery for the Confederate Army of Tennessee, which at the time was in Tullahoma, Tennessee, wintering. After some convincing, Streight's superiors adopted his plan. Union leaders supported the raid for several reasons. First, Confederate cavalry had recently led several successful raids of their own in Tennessee, Kentucky, and Missouri. Streight's plan, if successful, might bolster Union morale, as well as the pride of its mounted forces, which were kind of seen as a redhead stepchild to the Confederate cavalry at the time. Second, if the Union force could move uncontested across hundreds of miles in Confederate territory, such an action would weaken the Confederacy's legitimacy, as it proved incapable of either preventing nor halting such hostile incursions. Finally, Streight's raid was a diversion. This is the most important reason. It was a diversion for Colonel William Grierson's cavalry raid through Mississippi to strike Confederate supply lines in and around Vicksburg and to aid General Grant's efforts to capture the Confederacy's stronghold on the Mississippi River. Streight believed that the raid could be successful because in 1862 he had been stationed in northern Alabama, where he'd helped recruit hundreds of Alabama Unionists into the Union Army. Because of this experience, Streight thought that his raiders would be supported, aided, joined by Unionists along the route, kind of swelling his ranks and providing him all the resources that he would need. Streight also believed that the element of surprise would provide him with a strategical and tactical upper hand, because in his mind, a raid through northern Alabama to strike targets in Georgia would be completely unexpected by Confederate defenders, which it was. I mean, he really had the element of surprise, at least initially, it was a great asset for him at first. Streight also thought that his raiders would remain largely undetected as they raced through Alabama mountains because Union cavalry under command of General Granville Dodge, stationed in Corinth, Mississippi, would screen his movements and occupy area Confederate defenders. It is important to point out, however, that while Streight believed that he could reach Rome and destroy valuable Confederate assets, he also knew that once his initial mission had been achieved, there would be little chance that his men would escape capture. Also, Streight purposely kept the details of the raid secret, in part because he was worried that many of his own troops would view the mission as suicidal. As Streight received permission to launch his proposed raid, a number of problems developed that ultimately jeopardized the raid's chances for success. Really, he was doomed before he even started out, and several of these are just Union supply problems at the time. It took too long for Streight to actually launch his raid. That's the number one problem. A precious 14 days passed from the moment that Streight gathered his troops in and around Nashville until the raid actually commenced outside of Tuscumbia, Alabama. 2 weeks. Numerous factors combined to delay Streight's mission. He needed 1,700 mounts for the raid. Union commanders supplied him with mules, most of which were either unbroken or broken down. They gave him a lot of mules that had been used to pull wagons and so forth that basically died on him as they boarded the ship to sail up the Cumberland River and back down the Tennessee to get to Mississippi. And so right away, there's some problems there. Streight, all along the raid, had to spend precious time, days, in fact, in most places, scouring the countryside, looking for mules, horses, anything that his troops could ride. Plus, on top of that, not only did he give him mules, but most of his men, the vast majority of them, were completely unaccustomed to cavalry service. I mean, these were infantry units here. And what Streight had to do is the whole time that he was going along the route, especially during the early stages, he had to stop and train his men in cavalry exercises. And a lot of his men didn't know how to ride mules. A lot of men struggled to break in the mules. And there are all kinds of, I'm sorry I don't have the images for you, but there are all kinds of little sketch drawings that some of the soldiers made of the comedy of this whole thing. Soldiers are on the backs of mules, and mules are basically bucking them off and braying. They're flying off the front end of them. It's a great way to start a raid, at least morale-wise, for the Union soldiers. Union soldiers must have thought this whole thing was crazy at the time. And keep in mind, they hadn't been told yet exactly what they're going to be doing with these mules. So had they done so, they might have just shot the mules and gone back to Nashville or something. But why mules? You know, I think if you get anything from my presentation today, one thing I want to put out is that Abel Streight wasn't incompetent. I mean, he wasn't a buffoon. He wasn't a... Typically in Alabama stories and my stories growing up in Rome, Georgia, you know, the portrayal of Abel Streight is he's a buffoon and Forrest is this great military genius who just triumphs over him. And, you know, I definitely was washed in the myth of Nathan Bedford Forrest growing up as a kid. But, you know, looking on it, though, a lot of this really isn't his fault. And Streight actually does a pretty fine job during most of the raid, given the problems that he's going to have. But why mules? Union commanders could not provide Streight with horses in a timely manner. Had he waited for horses, it would have delayed the raid for months. And you might ask, well, why not? You know, just wait around for a little bit. One of the big reasons for the raid is to screen William Grierson's raid in Mississippi. That raid was going to be launched. And so Streight was a bit on the timetable himself. Also, another reason to not wait as well is because of Streight's own ambition. Streight was really worried that if this mission didn't start now, he would miss his chance. He was a person who, all throughout his life, both before the war, during the war, and after the war, was one who always wanted more, always wanted to be famous, and certainly wanted to make a great name for himself. And he's sort of in that category of Union soldiers worried the war might end, and nobody would remember Abel Streight served in the war. So he certainly wanted to make a name, and he certainly will by this. Unfortunately, the name will be Buffoon most of the time. I mean, that's how a lot of the Union soldiers and newspapers will portray him at the end of the war. Another reason that he didn't have the mules he needed was because of his commanding officer, General William Rosecrans. Initially, Rosecrans put in a requisition for horses for Streight's raid to help carry this out. But the Union quartermaster basically refused Rosecrans' request. The reason he did so is because Rosecrans had a really bad reputation for ruining horses. The horses were a very scarce resource for the Union Army, largely because they were raising much larger armies than the Confederacy was at the time. And they were stretched thin on the horses. And Rosecrans had already received large shipments of horses during the previous months to the start of Streight's raid. And so the quartermaster office was asking Rosecrans, well, why don't you use the horses I just sent you? And Rosecrans would say, well, you know, those horses are either dead or, you know, just had been, you know, unfit for service. And that led the quartermaster to ask, well, what are you doing to these horses that's causing this situation? Why would we give you more? And so in a way, you know, the mules was kind of a sign of William Rosecrans' own problems, kind of managing some of his the horses in his own command. Straight superiors, you often hear this, believe that mules would make an adequate substitute for horses because mules might be better suited for northern Alabama's hilly terrain. If you ride that little stretch from Tuscumbia, Alabama to Cedar Bluff, so forth, it's not the hilliest place on earth. They didn't particularly need mules for that. I think that's something Straight almost just told himself as he's starting out that it's going to be okay. You know, this will really work. But ultimately, the use of mules, though, really proved disastrous for a lot of different reasons. Number one, the mule's loud brain limited Straight's ability to conceal his movements. In fact, you can imagine, put 1,200 mules on a trail, and especially at night, Forrest actually comes upon Streight for the first time, and Forrest scouts don't have to go any closer. They can hear him. They can hear him off in the distance of about a mile and a half or so. And mule, I grew up in a rural area, and my neighbors had mules down the road. You could hear them all the time. So a mule, when they get going, can be heard about 2 miles away. You get 1,000 of them, well, imagine what you can hear. So that caused some major problems. And also, for many of the Union raiders, they saw this as a sign that they were almost destined to fail. You know, the Confederates were kind of making jokes of them, pretty much. You know, this jackass cavalry that's running around northern Alabama. I hope it's okay to say that here, but that definitely kind of hurt their zeal for this mission. Also, to make matters worse, at the start of the raid, he didn't even have enough mules. I mean, it would have been fine if he'd had enough mules, but at the start of the raid, about 200 of his men had to go on foot. So you've got a cavalry expedition that's all about getting from point A to point B as fast as you can, your own mules, which are already going to slow you down, and 200 of your men are on foot, which is going to slow you down even more. It was really a disaster from the start just from that. Another major problem for Streight was the person he was coordinating with, which was, let me get back to Granville Dodge. Y'all gonna laugh every time you see that, don't they? But the Granville Dodge, that was also a major part of his problem there. Straight's raid was supposed to be a very coordinated attack. coordinated by using Granville Dodge's forces to screen Streight's movements and basically distract and occupy Confederate forces in the region. You know, got to keep Forrest, who isn't there yet, but keep the Confederates in the area as busy as possible while Streight streaks across northern Alabama. The plan was called for Dodge's 7,500 cavalry to join Streight's 1,700 raiders when they disembarked their naval transports at Eastport, Mississippi. And Eastport, Mississippi is up in the corner there. You can see right there on the left. The Eastport on April 19th. Together, they were supposed to combine and then very quickly capture the city of Tuscumbia. And from Tuscumbia, then Streight was supposed to break off and basically start his raid, while Dodge held there and just kept the Confederate forces at bay for a while. The plan was compromised almost immediately. When Streight arrives at Eastport, he's getting the mules off the boat, and 200 of them run away. And this happened several times during the raid. This isn't the first time, though. And he had to spend about 2 days tracking down these mules and then finding additional mounts for his men at the same point. So, 48 hours are ticking by. And just keep this in your head, 48 hours. Forrest, in a span of about 48 hours, gets from south of Nashville to basically Day's Gap in that same amount of time. So, time isn't something that Streight's definitely kind of losing all throughout the raid. Another problem was, right away, the element of surprise was almost gone from the moment they got there. Confederate Colonel Philip Roddy's scouts reported the Union landing to Braxton Bragg, thus compromising this element of surprise. And that's what first kind of gets Forrest kind of moving down towards the region there, and that Bragg kind of understands what's going on here now. Roddy commanded the Alabama Cavalry Brigade, which consisted of 100 cavalry assigned to monitor enemy movements in northern Alabama. Roddy came from humble origins and had worked, among other jobs, as a tailor prior to the war. He opposed secession, but later formed a cavalry company and had served with distinction in several battles. And he'll kind of play a key role in the early parts of the raid. 2 days before Streight's men arrived in Eastport, Granville Dodge had grown impatient with Streight's delays. Granville Dodge was stationed in Corinth, Mississippi, and he's basically waiting for Streight's men to get to Eastport, join up, and then combine and go move forward and attack. Well, Granville Dodge is sitting there just going, where's Streight at? He's not coming along. So Dodge finally grows impatient and decides he's just going to go out on his own. And that's what he does. He moves his forces toward Tuscumbia without Streight. However, though, Roddy's skirmishers, however, pick up Dodge's movements immediately. And following a brief engagement, Roddy basically forces Dodge to halt and reverse course going back towards Corinth before he could ever get things off the ground. To make matters worse, Dodge's scouts, and this is going to be another problem all throughout the raid, Dodge's scouts grossly overestimated Roddy's forces. Scouts reported that Roddy's forces exceeded 6,000, which is just absurd. In reality, Roddy had about 1,200 cavalry, really. But this is something that happens time and time again in this raid. The Union Army thinks they're facing this big, giant Confederate cavalry out there, when in reality, they're facing just a few hundred men, usually, at any given time. Poor scouting by Union forces definitely plagued the entire raid. Finally, on April 23rd, Dodge and Streight's forces combined to move toward Tuscumbia. They faced minimal resistance from a handful of Confederate skirmishers. On April 24th, they captured Tuscumbia, which went back and forth between Union and Confederate hands a lot during the war. Upon arriving there, Streight needed an additional 3 days, to forage for food and mounts before he could launch the raid. So even since he's arrived in Alabama, he's wasted a week pretty much, trying to get things together. Streight's raid finally began at 11 o'clock at night on April 26th during a miserable rainstorm. And a critical 14 days had passed since his forces had left Nashville. Meanwhile, soon-to-be opponent General Nathan Bedford Forrest required just 3 days to move his 1,600 cavalry division from Spring Hill, Tennessee, down to Tuscumbia. So he closes the gap pretty fast on Streight. Streight's best hope rested upon Dodge's ability to occupy Confederate forces that were gathering in the vicinity of Tuscumbia. Unfortunately for Streight, Mother Nature and Dodge's indecisiveness quickly dashed those hopes. Heavy rainfall swelled the local creeks that now separated Dodge from the Confederate cavalry that he was supposed to engage. Confederates wisely defended the one or two passable fords and a railroad bridge, thus keeping Dodge's superior forces and firepower at bay. Meanwhile, Forrest received a report that a smaller force had broken off from Dodge's main force and was believed to be headed south towards Russellville. Forrest did not react to this news immediately. However, when Dodge retreated toward Corinth, Mississippi on April 29th, Forrest was free then to pursue the raiders. Dodge had chosen to retreat because he falsely believed that Forrest had moved his forces toward Decatur and were thus no longer a threat to Streight's men. Again, Dodge made this decision based on incorrect information passed along by his scouts. Had Dodge pursued Forrest and Roddy with greater vigor, he would have bought Streight some much-needed time, and Streight probably would have made it to Rome. Basically, Dodge is the key element in all this. Dodge turns and moves west, and at that point, Confederate cavalry can do what they want, and they're able to chase down Streight. Forrest acted quickly once Dodge was no longer a threat. He divided his forces into several regiments and Roddy's cavalry to Florence and Tuscumbia to serve as a barrier between Dodge and Streight's forces, ensured that Union forces would be unable to collaborate, basically. Forrest took personal command of the 4th and 9th Tennessee Cavalry, as well as a Georgia artillery battery, and after a brief rest, set out to track down the Union raiders. Sometime around midnight on April 28th, Forrest and his men left Courtland, Alabama, moving southward towards Day's Gap. On the night of April 29th, Streight and his troops camped at Day's Gap, unaware that the Confederates were nearby. The scene in the camp was one of quiet confidence. Among Streight's raiders were the 1st Alabama Cavalry, USA. Most of these Unionist Alabamians were from the area around Coleman, Bluntsville, and Gadsden, places they knew they would travel through en route to Rome. Some of them had joined the Union Army in response to Streight's recruitment efforts the previous fall. And on the night of April 29th, Streight still thinks he's kind of snuck away, and that things are going pretty well. Well, the next day, everything's going to start to fall apart pretty quick for Streight. Despite the fact that Streight had had nearly a 48-hour head start, Forrest caught up with him near Day's Gap during the early morning hours of April 30th. Streight cited poor roads as the principal cause for his slow movements, but Forrest's cavalry moved faster over many of those same routes. I mean, it's not really an excuse. The fact that nearly 200 of Streight's men still lacked horses or mules slowed his movements and forced him to rest his mounted troops while waiting for his foot-weary soldiers to kind of catch up. Basically, his horses would get so far ahead, they'd have to stop and wait half a day for the men to kind of catch up, and that really slowed them down significantly. To make matters worse, at Day's Gap, Roddy's cavalry, as well as the rest of Forrest's cavalry, reunited with them outside of Day's Gap because Dodge's forces had completely left the area. There was no one there to defend anymore, so now they could all unite and strike Streight as a combined force. At the start of Day's Gap, Forrest had about 2,000 men total. So this is about as many men as he'll have during the whole campaign. He dispatched two regiments consisting of 800 men to race northward to serve as a block, basically, to ensure that Streight couldn't retreat northward at any point, and also just kind of keep tabs on Streight's movements as the raid's going to continue. On the morning of April 30th, Streight's men moved out through Day's Gap towards the long ascent atop Sand Mountain, Alabama. Streight awoke early that morning and led a column of his raiding party eastward. Streight's forces, however, soon became scattered along several miles. His rear guard was still cooking breakfast at their campsite. Suddenly, Confederate artillery pounded the camp, and from the distance rose the sound of rushing horses and the slow crescendo of the rebel yell. The assault temporarily stunned Streight, who to his credit quickly recovered and organized a proper defense. Uncertain of who attacked him, he initially thought the attack had been carried out by local home guard. He placed his men in line in the middle of the pass in Day's Gap, protected by a ravine on one side and marshland on the other. Streight ordered his rear guard to delay the Confederate assault temporarily before falling back to rejoin the main defense. Thus began the Battle of Day's Gap. Forrest, however, had his own problems. His units were also scattered and somewhat disorganized. Several days of hard riding left many lingering along the roadside for miles. Upon seeing Streight's position, Forrest ordered a combined charge of infantry and cavalry to be supported by artillery. What was supposed to be a unified attack became a piecemeal assault that allowed Streight's men to pour deadly concentrated fire upon isolated Confederate attackers. At the height of the battle, Streight ordered a countercharge as he sent the 3rd Ohio and 80th Illinois Infantry headlong into Forrest's advancing lines. These are battle-hardened infantrymen fighting against cavalry here. Under withering fire, the men from Ohio, who yelled like Mohawks in their account, they had to have something similar to the rebel yell, captured two of Forrest's prized artillery pieces, sending the Confederates into full retreat. The loss of the artillery pieces so enraged Forrest that he was ferocious and wild as an animal, they describe. He basically threw a temper tantrum right after he lost those two feats. He moved among his retreating men, hitting them with the flat side of his saber, physically urging them to stand their ground and warning them that he would recapture those guns if everyone in his unit died trying. Forrest blamed Forrest blamed Lieutenant A. Willis Gould for the loss of his prize guns. These were guns that Forrest had captured at the Battle of Stones River. They were kind of prizes to him. Forrest never forgave Gould. After Streight's raid had ended, Gould and Forrest had an altercation that began as a heated exchange that eventually became violent threats. Forrest had a lot of these in his life. Violent threats that quickly escalated into deadly force. Gould basically pulled a pistol on Forrest. The pistol snagged as he drew it, ended up shooting Forrest in the hip. Forrest, who's wounded in the hip, has a penknife in his hand. Apparently he's opened some letters, grabs Gould, pulls him up, and then almost guts him with a penknife as he stands there. Afterwards, Gould kind of runs off or stumbles off, and Forrest goes on this maddened rage around town looking for Gould to shoot him and finish him off. Eventually he finds him. The guy's laying in a ditch, pretty much dead, and Forrest thinks better of it than maybe I shouldn't execute this guy here. And actually the two make up. Unfortunately, Gould dies anyway. I mean, Gould dies because of a Forrest thing. So those are kind of the incidents that kind of lived on after Streight. You know, Forrest didn't let a lot of these issues just die with the raid, and he kind of carried some grudges of, you know, some of them for the rest of his life. In the hours after the battle, Forrest trimmed his forces significantly. Upset at General Roddy's poor performance, Forrest dispatched him, as well as several regiments, to Decatur. Fewer than 1,000 cavalry remained with Forrest, primarily his trusted 4th and 9th Tennessee Cavalry. By the afternoon of April 30th, a full-fledged race had developed. Streight pushed his men hard to the east while being closely pursued by Forrest to his rear, as well as smaller detachments of Forrest's men that had constantly harassed his ranks. By the late afternoon, Forrest threatened to overrun Streight's rear guard. This forced Streight to make another defensive stand, this time along a ridge called Hog Mountain. Streight made a formal defensive line, but his efforts were undermined by his continued belief that Forrest's men greatly outnumbered his own. Streight therefore saw these defensive stands as nothing more than stalling tactics, rather than opportunities for pitched battles. If he just stood and fought him, he would have probably defeated Forrest pretty easily, but he constantly believed Forrest was much bigger than he was and kept retreating. At Hog Mountain, the two sides fought into the night on April 30th. It was rare in the Civil War to have a night battle. With Forrest at the head of the line, Confederate forces valiantly charged the Union defenses on several occasions. One of the attacking Confederates recalled that Forrest's actions had, quote, created a grand spectacle on the battlefield. Streight's battle-tested men, however, did not waver, repeatedly repulsing the onslaught for more than 3 hours. Despite the successful stand, Streight did not feel that continuing the fight would benefit his larger objective, which was striking the Western Atlantic Railroad and the city of Rome. Battered by combat and running low on artillery munitions, Streight ordered the captured Confederate guns that had been used that night to decimate Confederate ranks spiked, and that his men resumed their raid. Due to the large number of wounded soldiers, Streight asked Assistant Surgeon William Spencer of the 73rd Infantry to set up a field hospital and remain with the wounded as the Union left. Spencer watched as his Union brigade left and as their Confederate pursuers soon overran the hospital. Spencer's heroic actions did not go unnoticed by the Confederates and Forrest. After a brief meeting, Forrest and Spencer left one another's company on amicable terms. Spencer became a captured yet respected carelessly cared for the wounded Union and Confederate soldiers alike. Spencer described Forrest as, quote, a pleasant, good-looking man who was gracious and evidenced good breeding and generosity among otherwise rude band of Confederate horsemen. Basically, Forrest was of a better class than his men, at least in Spencer's eyes. Spencer also commented that, quote, the men and the officers had great respect for General Forrest, which was intermingled with a little wholesome fear. And altogether, he makes a better fight with his ragamuffins than one would suppose. The next morning, Streight arrived in Bluntsville. There, he received some much-needed supplies, as well as horses, but could not provide much time for his men to rest. In Bluntsville, Streight also rid himself of another growing problem, refugee slaves. Small numbers of slaves had followed Streight's men for several days, and as he reached Bluntsville, their numbers had climbed in the immediate area. Streight could not feed them, and their presence in his rear threatened to further slow his movements. Sadly, Streight, although an ardent abolitionist, expelled the slaves from his lines. It didn't really do him much good, because almost as soon as he left Bluntsville, more started to follow. It was kind of a problem for the raiders, and something that they'll learn later on as well in other movements of how to deal with better. A few hours after Streight arrived at Bluntsville, Forrest's vanguard reached the city, forcing the exhausted Union raiders to resume their flight across the Alabama countryside. Locals reported to Forrest about the poor condition of Streight's men. Forrest promptly divided his forces into smaller units, enabling portions of his force to continue chasing and harassing Streight while others rested, so just kind of attacked in piecemeal, basically. It was clear that Streight's men were worn out, and Forrest wanted to press this advantage to balance out his own inferior numbers, which were now fewer than 600. Outside of Bluntsville, Streight ran into serious problems. Earlier, Streight had ordered all of the raid supplies to be carried on the backs of mules rather than by wagon. Unbeknownst to Union soldiers, as Streight's men crossed the swollen Black Warrior River and then Wills Creek, large amounts of ammunition got drenched and could no longer be used effectively. On May 2nd, Streight still had one chance of escape. There was only one passable bridge over Black Creek, which is located between Bluntsville and Gadsden. He crossed the bridge first, set up his artillery on the east bank, and then set fire to the bridge, rendering it impassable for the pursuing Confederates. Forrest needed to cross Black Creek to keep pace with Streight. Fortunately, he discovered the Sansom family. Which consisted of Widow Sansom, her husband had died several years earlier, and her two teenage daughters, Emma and Jenny. Forrest asked the women for help locating a place to cross the creek. 16-year-old Emma Sansom spoke up, telling the general about a crossing nearby where cattle could cross the creek even when the creek was high. Forrest pulled the young girl atop his horse as the two crept through a wooded area in search of Sansom's crossable ford. Under constant fire from Union soldiers on the opposite bank, Sansom quickly showed Forrest the location, and the two returned to the Sansom home. Before departing, Forrest reportedly asked for a lock of Sanson's hair and scribbled a poorly written note filled with misspellings thanking Sansom for her service. He also asked the family to bury one of his soldiers, Robert Turner, a request they honored the following morning. If you go to Gadsden, too, in that median, the grave of Robert Turner's right there by the historical market there. Sansom and Forrest's interaction lasted less than an hour, but her name would live on forever as the Confederate heroine from Alabama. Forrest's men quickly crossed Black Creek and resumed their pursuit of Streight's men, who had now passed through Gadsden and stopped at Blunt's plantation about 12 miles away to rest his tired men in anticipation of an all-night fight. Meanwhile, Streight sent a detachment of about 200 men on towards Rome, hoping that they could secure the town prior to the arrival of the main body of raiders. While in Gadsden, Streight's men had gathered some supplies and caused some damage to local property. They cut a hole in John Wisdom's ferry. Upon learning that Union soldiers were headed towards Rome, Wisdom began his long, heroic ride across the countryside to warn the city of Rome and his mother, who lived in Rome, of the impending danger. He rode approximately 67 miles. It took him 8.5 hours to do so. He exhausted 5 horses, 1 mule. Mules are never good on any of these things. And survived a nasty fall that nearly killed him. He almost blacked out at one point in the raid, taking a severe hit to his head. Wisdom's actions allowed Colonel George Black, head of the local militia in Rome, to organize a defense to prevent Union raiders from crossing the covered bridge over the Coosa River. A train dispatched to nearby Kingston, Georgia, helped spread the alarm, and in the morning returned loaded with soldiers and civilians who would defend the town. By the morning of May 3rd, which is when Streight would have arrived, had all gone well, Rome had organized a defense of more than 200 defenders and had rigged the bridge. As soon as they had seen Streight, they were going to set fire to the bridge and burn it down anyway. So while Winston's actions raised the alarm, Rome's fate was further protected by the actions of an elderly slave encountered by federal cavalry as they approached the city. The slave told Union raiders that a large force of defenders occupied the city and the city was prepared to defend itself. The Union commander halted his force and sent word back to Colonel Streight that Rome could not be taken by force. As Rome prepared to repulse the Yankee invaders, Colonel Streight formed his men into a defensive line at Blunt's plantation, ready to meet Forrest in battle. As Forrest's men crashed into the federal lines, Streight realized for the first time that large amounts of his ammunition had been soaked and was useless. He also lost 2 key commanders among his troops, and his losses at that one engagement exceeded all the losses total for his campaign up to that point. Things were going from bad to worse for Streight. During the battle, Streight captured a Confederate soldier named William Haynes, who did the best service for Forrest at this point. Streight interrogated Haynes, asked him about Forrest's number of men, his strength in general, and Haynes, just like any good Confederate soldier, greatly exaggerated, to the point that after he gets this report from Haynes, Streight's reported to have said, quote, "Gentlemen, they have us," talking to his own men. Streight's men were exhausted. They were running out of ammunition and convinced that they were facing a superior force. Streight's officers urged him to surrender. Under a flag of truce, Streight and Forrest met to discuss terms and met out in the field. Streight was not convinced that surrender was the only option. He was a very proud man. He didn't just want to lay down. He wanted to kind of go down fighting. And it was his men who were really pushing him to do this. He was convinced that surrender wasn't his only option. He demanded that Forrest expose his full force to show him, these men that these captured Confederates had talked about. But Forrest, whose forces numbered fewer than 400, refused. In fact, when Forrest met him, honestly, Streight couldn't see 10 other Confederate soldiers in the area. Forrest very wisely put two of his regiments off in the woods, off to the side, off the flank there, and they were very hidden in the dense wood. Streight kind of knew they were over there, but couldn't get a good count of them. The only Confederate force he could really see were two artillery pieces that Forrest had managed to keep with him during the raid, and there was a little knobby hill off to the right up behind Forrest, and Streight saw those pieces come up, and very smartly, Forrest had his men take those pieces down, circle back around the hill, put the pieces back up, take them down, circle around the hill, put them back up. And so Forrest knew, Forrest's a very wily guy. Forrest could see Streight's eyes looking over his shoulder and counting those guns. And supposedly, now don't get me wrong, there's a lot of stuff that gets said in this raid that probably never was actually said, but supposedly at one point, Streight told him, well, how many guns do you have? basically, to Streight, how the hell did you carry all these? So at first, Streight refused to surrender. He actually said, you're bluffing, and pretty much went back to his men. But at that point, his men told him, you're surrendering, you've got to surrender. And so they basically forced Streight to do so. When Streight's men stacked there were 1,400 of Streight's men, as they stacked their arms, Forrest finally revealed his entire force, which was now slightly more than 400. I mean, it's not a menacing force by any degree. Streight felt that he had been duped. He had a 3-to-1 advantage over Forrest. Streight demanded that Forrest return their arms and let the two sides fight it out, but Forrest reportedly, that would have been very noble of Forrest, I guess, if he had done so, but I don't know how good it would have done Streight either. They damaged a lot of their guns before they stacked them, too. So, I mean, probably still would have ended up in suicide. But anyway, that's what Forrest demanded. And then at this point, Forrest supposedly told him, Colonel, don't you know all is fair in love and war? And I will say a lot of those quotes to Forrest, Forrest was very cognizant of the media. He had newspaper men and his staff from Memphis and who constantly reported and embellished a lot of these quotes. There's a reason we have 1.5 million quotes from Nathan Bedford Forrest. It's because he had good publicists, basically. And so whether or not he actually said any of these things, I would say very loosely that he didn't, probably. The captured raiders, at that point, Streight's captured. The captured raiders were taken to Rome, Georgia, where they received a mixed treatment from civilians. As Forrest received a hero's welcome and a horse from the locals as a sign of appreciation, civilians then engaged in a black market trade that soon devolved into outright looting of federal prisoners, basically stripping the federal men of anything of value as they were in the city of Rome. It's at this point that the raid really becomes a problem, though. What do you do with these raiders? Here they are, these captured Union soldiers. Are they spies or combatants? And there was a real debate going on among the Confederate government and the governor of Alabama. The governor of Alabama saw them as spies. Some members of the Confederate government saw them as spies. In fact, Streight, when he first started the raid, had actually advised that they not wear Union uniforms at all, that they go in civilian dress. That was quickly dismissed. Unfortunately for Streight, it was, because he probably would have been executed had he followed that. But should they be treated as spies or combatants? And one of the reasons the Confederacy really wanted to treat them as spies is because they claimed that Streight, as he was traveling through northern Alabama, was inciting a slave rebellion as well. And that's a great fear. I study the history of Northwest Georgia, and in Northwest Georgia, that's their greatest fear out of all this. They're not really worried about Streight burning the city of Rome. Nobody's really worried about that. What they're worried about is this abolitionist Yankee running amok in an area that has a large slave population, which is Northwest Georgia, and particularly raising a slave rebellion. And they wanted to make an example of him in a way. So ultimately, they're treated as combatants. But there was a debate for a while. Then there's also debate, what do you do with the 1st Alabama Cavalry? These are Unionists from Alabama. They committed treason. The governor of Alabama wanted them to come back to Alabama and face civil tribunals you know, civil trials. Forrest, much to his credit, actually protected their identity at several points. There were several inquiries made by the governor of Alabama asking exactly how many Unionists are there in this captured group. And Forrest outright lied several times and said, well, you know, most of those guys got away before I captured them. You know, so for whatever reason he did hide that. A lot of them did end up in Alabama prisons, though. Many of them ended up in prisons scattered throughout Alabama for portions of the war. Eventually, the prisoners go from Rome to Atlanta and then up to Libby Prison in Richmond. The enlisted men were exchanged, which was pretty common still at that point. Some of the officers, though, remained in prison for the rest of the war. Straight, actually, at one point, becomes a very escape artist, basically. He tries to escape several times, and he's actually finally successful one time. He and his men actually tunnel out of the prison. Straight, they make a joke about this, too, about Straight. He was a bit corpulent guy, a little fat, and he got stuck in the tunnel going out, had to back out, take off his clothes, tie them to his legs, and then go back. There are all these embarrassing stories about Straight, you know, but anyway, so eventually he rejoins his regiment and fights kind of the rest of the war. And the real significance of a lot of this is what happened to Emma Sansom. You know, Emma Sansom, after the Alabama legislature authorized 640 acres in honor of Emma Sansom. The Reconstruction Congress, though, when they got in, denied this grant, basically did away with it. Then later on, the state legislature restored this grant. She never really got it, though. You know, the poor thing is, I spent a lot of time trying to discover Emma Sansom more and more through the records and county records in Texas. And, you know, she led a pretty ordinary life. I mean, she marries, she moves to Texas. You know, in the late 1890s, John Wyeth, who's a Forrest biographer, tracks her down, interviews her. That's how we have most of the account from her view of the trail. Throughout most of her life, she still receives requests from people for locks of her hair, you know, different things like that, different stories. If in the Confederate Veteran magazine, there's tons of accounts of Emma Sansom. You would think Emma Sansom was Forrest, you know, just in the number of accounts that are out there about her. In 1906, Gadsden erects a statue in honor of her. Let's see here, yeah, in honor of her. And, you know, all over the country, there's a SCV chapter in Louisiana named after her. There's a high school named after her. She's by far, you know, probably the most significant person that kind of emerges from this. So finally, just to kind of close, you know, why is this raid significant? If you look at it just purely as the impact upon the war, the impact upon the war was really that the raid served as a decoy for William Grierson's successful raid through Mississippi. That's the most important part. While Forrest is trouncing across northern Alabama, Forrest is falling, Forrest is supposedly the greatest cavalry genius in the Confederacy. Well, Forrest is over here when there's a lot going on over here, and that's going to end up being a major problem for the Confederacy. Confederate civilians also saw this as a major victory. I have tons of letters from my people in Bartow County who are writing after this raid about this great, grand victory. And at the end of the war, as Atlanta's about to fall, these civilians are listing the great Confederate victories that have happened over the years, and Straight's raid is always high on their list, even though tactically and strategically it did very little of anything. And finally, it also furthers the view, at least during the war, of the Union as being incompetent. You know, these are incompetent cavalry raiders and so forth. You know, in the memory, the way in which Alabamians remember the war, this raid's very significant because of Emma Sansom. You know, Sansom becomes Alabama's Confederate heroine, a woman who played a role in assisting Confederate men in battle, which was really big for the UDC in the years after the war. She became a symbol of bravery, loyalty, and a symbol of Alabama's Confederate support. It really showed that even in this Unionist area that is northern Alabama, here was this brave 16-year-old girl willing to risk it all. Straight's raid, in a very small way, helped Alabama become Alabama. Tales of heroism, devotion, pride, and ingenuity form the main body of a thrilling narrative that Alabamians have shared for 150 years and likely will continue to share among future generations. Thank y'all.
Size of Straight's force at the beginning, you said it was 1,400 at the end.
Yeah. Straight's, it's really hard to get approximate figures for even Straight and definitely for Forrest during the raid. At one point, from the best I can gather from the records and so forth, Straight's force at most was 1,700 men at one point. Straight eventually surrenders. He'd actually, the biggest losses he had had during the whole campaign were at Day's Gap and then at Hog Mountain. He lost a few. But I have a feeling, though, what really happened is as Forrest is running behind him the whole time, Forrest is picking up a lot of the stragglers from Straight's command. He sends a lot of those stragglers to places like Decatur, Alabama for kind of temporary safekeeping and other places. And then at the end of the raid, a lot of those stragglers end up getting rejoined to the unit. So, it's really hard because Forrest doesn't report numbers for his own men, and Straight really kind of concealed his own forces even at the end, because for Straight it's a very embarrassing situation, and the Confederates are constantly kind of embellishing how many men Straight had lost, and so it's really hard to just kind of go off of any reports that the Confederates put out right away because they're a bit exaggerated. Yeah. Did that answer your question?
We have a question.
Yeah.
I saw on your map of the raid it mentioned Crooked Creek. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Oh, yeah, you asked me to talk about Crooked Creek. Yeah. What happened at Crooked? What did you want me to talk about at Crooked Creek?
Talk about what happened there during the raid.
Oh.
I noticed there was a modern museum there that talks about the battle. That's why.
Yeah, I'm having a brain moment. But there were lots of. I mean, basically, from the moment they left Tuscumbia, it was a at least from the moment they left Day's Gap, there was a running skirmish. Basically, I mean, the only real battle in the whole campaign was at Day's Gap, and that's where they sat and actually formed. All along the line, though, if you did other people have already done this, a driving tour of the route, and there are all kinds of sites there where, Straight made temporarily defenses. One thing I didn't get to talk about is Straight constantly tried to put out ambushes for the Confederates, and that's another thing he did at Crooked Creek. He had ambushes set up, but the Confederates were constantly able to kind of smell these out and destroy them before they caused any kind of serious damage to the Confederates, mainly because of their stupid mules. I mean, the mules really kind of wrecked things. But, the real thing, as you see that map, really all along that trail, I mean, most of it, Forrest is only about a mile behind Straight during most of it. And one thing that's really unfortunate is that 1st Alabama Cavalry, that U.S. group, they are Straight's rear guard. And so they're bearing the brunt of most of this assault time and time and time again. But you could find dozens of points along there where they had skirmishes, ambushes set up, so forth and so on. Thank you.
Is it true that the Sansom home was pillaged as they came through, and that just sort of really kind of motivated Emma?
Yeah, well, yeah, you were asking, was the Sansom home ravaged or ransacked by Union soldiers as they came through? I don't think so. Sanson's own version of it doesn't really speak to that. I mean, certainly she had encounters with Union soldiers as they came through. The Union went into the home. Apparently the fire that they got to burn the bridge came from the Sanson home. There wasn't a great deal of looting. They really didn't have that much time. I mean, Forrest was pretty much right on their tail during most of this. And the whole point of getting across the creek was to get across as fast as you can. They had to set fire to it, set up a defensive position to then kind of stall a little bit longer. So, it's not a moment. And in fact, there's all kinds of different accounts. I mean, to what degree did Straight's men cause damage to civilian property all along the route? I mean, they certainly were taking food. They certainly were taking horses. They passed out IOUs from the federal government left and right to folks as they went along. But there's actually very little account of Straight's men, mainly because they just didn't have time, I think, of burning civilian homes or ransacking or stealing items from there. Yes.
How can a cavalry unit comprised of hundreds of men moving rapidly be supplied?
How can a cavalry unit of hundreds of men moving rapidly be supplied? Yeah, the best way to do that is to forage as you go along the countryside. And that's what Forrest, you know, Streight's men definitely tried to do. Their biggest problem was just getting basic mounts, you know, basic horses or mules. I mean, that's really, and even at certain points, they couldn't get enough feed for them. They couldn't even get enough water for them. I'm remembering now. So at one point, they get to a creek, and they're trying to cross as fast as they can, and they get the mules out into the creek, and the mules won't go across because they're so thirsty. They start drinking and drinking, and, you know, literally, there's a comical scene of Union's men getting off the mules and trying to pull them across the creek. I mean, you know, for most of them, by the time the raid ended, for most of the Union, they hadn't slept for about 4 days, really. And a lot of them were just in very, I wasn't able to mention this, but when they surrender at Cedar Bluff, one of the reasons they surrender is the troops are lined up to prepare a defensive line against Forrest, and they're ready to fight, and they do fight a little bit. There's a skirmish there. But in between the skirmishes, Streight's men fall asleep in the line. I mean, they're just so tired, they're so famished, basically, you know, from the assault that they're just basically in trouble. They are able to scavenge or forage a good bit in the area, though. The area hadn't been touched that much by, you know, the Civil War up to that point. They were able to find food. Yeah.
I'm thinking more of Forrest moving rapidly than this. How does he stay supplied with ammunition, for instance? You can't forage.
Yeah, sure. Well, one advantage that Forrest had is he had a large force at one point, and Forrest had up to about 2,000 men at one point in the raid. That's early on. I mean, he basically gets mad at Philip Roddy, and he sends his men off, and he sends other men around the flank to kind of keep Streight from moving north and so forth. But Forrest was well supplied, I mean, at least where ammunition goes. Forrest also very smartly learned a lesson that Streight didn't learn. When Forrest is crossing, you know, the rain, it was raining during the whole raid pretty much. I mean, the horrible weather during the raid. All the creeks were swollen. As Forrest crossed a lot of the creeks, he made very careful, it took great care to make sure the ammunition didn't get wet. He had men actually carry ammunition across the creek rather than having it being transported on the back of a horse or something like that. And so he actually saved a lot of his ammunition. Plus, they picked up a lot. I mean, they're picking up Union stragglers almost the whole raid. So they're picking up weapons from the Union. They're picking up all kinds of things. I mean, it was really easy to track Streight's raiders. This is in all the accounts by Forrest's men, because wherever Streight's men went, there was a scattering of just litter, basically. Some of it is, you know, materials, the actual materials they're leaving behind as they're kind of skedaddling in advance there. But Forrest did have supply problems, though. One of the biggest ones is just fodder for his horses. At one point, he comments that his horses had only had 4 ears of corn apiece during part of the raid, and that they just couldn't go much further. I mean, Forrest is just as lucky that Streight surrenders at Cedar Bluff, because Forrest, too, is exhausted. I mean, his force is not really going to be able to pursue for much longer either, because their horses are in really bad shape.
We have time for one more question.
Oh, sure. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that the governor got involved after this incident occurred, and which raises the question that there was a state election scheduled for August of that year. This is just a few months beforehand. You also mentioned that some of the 1st Alabama Cavalry USA, Forrest said, had dropped off along the way and had gotten away. Wonder if there was a political angle to this. I wonder if the Unionists were dropping off intentionally, that was part of the reason for the raid was to reseed that area with some Unionist leaders to influence that very significant 1863 election. Did you see any evidence of that?
No, he asked if the main point of the raid was to kind of disperse these Unionists among this Union-friendly area. Yeah. No, I mean, really, the 1st Alabama, they really fought. Like I said, during most of this skirmishing and fighting that's going on, most of these ambushes, it's the 1st Alabama USA that really bear the brunt of most of this campaign for Streight. They are Streight's rear guard. And basically, whenever you hear an account during the raid, hey, the men were cooking breakfast and all of a sudden Forrest on their position, that was the rear guard. And so, you know, a lot of times by the end of the campaign, you know, a lot of them don't have ammunition. A lot of them are missing vital supplies because they've had to constantly abandon their campsites and supplies because they just constantly get surprised. I mean, they're definitely there to the end. I mean, there's some stragglers for sure that kind of not necessarily sneak off, but just through a long campaign sort of drag behind that get picked up by Forrest. But they're definitely there. I mean, there's a lot of the stories about Forrest I still, you know, want to explore and try to understand a little more. But, you know, I do find it surprising that Forrest, at least in his letters early on, certainly did not favor treating these Alabama cavalrymen as spies, basically, mainly because the brunt of the forces, as he's, you know, Forrest was out at front most of the time too. You know, Forrest is leading the men into these USA rear guard, and so he had experienced fighting these guys too for several days. So I think Forrest had a respect for, you know, troops that he faced in battle, at least most of them. You could debate that a little bit with Fort Pillow, but you know, at least in this case, he probably sought out their best interest.
A follow-up announcement. I want to mention to you an important milestone in the preservation of one of the battlefields or one of the sites that Keith mentioned today, which is the Hog Mountain Battlefield in Coleman County. Mr. Henry Simpson is with us today. He's been very active in the national effort to preserve Civil War battlefields through the Civil War Trust, and there's going to be a dedication of a marker next Saturday, April 27th, at Hog Mountain at 10:30 a.m. This is just about 6 or 7 miles off of I-65 there in Coleman County. And I have copies of directions to that location. If any of you are interested, I'll have those up here at the front after the program. Thank you again, Dr. Abear.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, everyone.